I have loved this album, Ballad of the Blues, for a long time. Would you tell me what you remember about the genesis of the album?
It started, of course, thinking of the songs themselves, and then Paul and I had a couple of sessions with Marilyn and Alan Bergman, who did all of the lyrics for the special material. It evolved itself into a kind of a project all of us were interested in.
Who thought of the idea?
I expect most likely Paul, and the two of us, I guess, came up with it.
It seems like it would have been a daring thing to do.
Well, you could almost call it an indulgence, I guess. We wanted to do it so badly that I don't think either one of us, including the Bergmans, had any hope for great commercial success.
How did it do?
Well, it held its own. It didn't set any houses on fire, but all of us just loved the idea so much and wanted to do it so much that we just sort of said, well, we're going to do it whether or no.
Was the idea of a concept album something that you came up with? Now we call them concept albums. Had you been aware of similar albums?
I lean towards that. I like that better than just a random list of unconnected songs. Mm. I like the idea of a theme, if you want to call it a reason for doing whatever songs you choose. I like to have a theme. I feel comfortable with it.
Did the record company give you trouble?
No, I don't think so. I don't know that they were crazy about it or anything like that, but they didn't give us any problem. Mm-mm.
What is it that attracts you to a song initially?
Probably the harmonic structure. I'm a big fan of chords and bass notes. Probably the music attracts me first, but the lyrics have something to do too. You know, there are words, it sounds funny, there are words that are unsingable.
Oh, yes.
I like the idea of all the words I have to sing, they're singable words.
Sure. How did you meet the Bergmans?
Let me see. I think we met the Bergmans through Norman Luboff. He was our original connection with them, and of course we became real, real good friends.
You worked with them on your television series in London.
Yes, they went with me. I made about, I think 10 or 11 hour shows.
I assume they wrote new songs for you with Paul and what we call special material, routines. Did they write scenes? Did they work on larger concepts?
We worked here before we all went to London to do the shows so that there was a running theme through each show. It just wasn't a collection of songs.
So much of variety television at that time was not connected in that way, and again, it's very forward-thinking.
I always feel more comfortable. Instead of just standing up and saying, I'm now going to sing Sweet Sue, I'd rather have a reason, no matter how flimsy.
With Ballad of the Blues, it seems to me, listening to it, that one of the tricks with such classic Americana is to decide how you're going to interpret it. How do you take famous blues and folk songs and treat them respectfully and yet update them in a way that is palatable to a contemporary audience? Did you consider those things at the time?
I don't really think we did. Maybe we just really indulged ourselves, but I don't think we did.
Interesting, because it all sounds so perfect for your voice and so natural in that when you sing something like Over Yonder-o, which is sort of antique speech, it sounds very simple and easy.
My folks, my mother and dad, both were from the mountains of Tennessee, so I come by the folk songs quite naturally, my mother having sung several for me and knew the ones I did, so that it didn't come as a surprise, things like Over Yonder-o.
Were there many of the songs on the Ballad of the Blues that were songs you remembered from your childhood that you wanted to particularly include? It begins with Blues is an Old Story and Street Cries, John Henry.
Yeah, John Henry.
And I think I hear Thurl Ravenscroft on there. Is that the low voice I hear?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Who later became Tony the Tiger. They're great. I love the way that the original material weaves so effortlessly in and out of the songs.
Yeah, that fascinated me too, and I appreciated that a great deal. Nothing felt strange. You know, everything was natural, and that's good.
It's the best. How much rehearsal do you need before you record something?
In my days, as they say, we came up with four sides in 3 hours. So that's about 45 minutes per. there are times when Paul would slip music under the door while I was taking a bath before the record date. I was just supposed to come up with everything in 10 minutes. Sometimes, that's the truth, sometimes I didn't know the material until a very short time before it was recorded. In the case of the ballad, of course, the Ballad of the Blues, I was familiar with most of that. And the original stuff that Paul wrote between songs was such a natural. It was no big chore to learn that.
You read music very quickly, very easily.
Yeah, I can't read it as fast as I can read words, but I can read it pretty good, yeah. Of course, I got my first reading knowledge from piano lessons. That was one thing my mother insisted on. We all took piano lessons, and I guess I was the one that was most interested in it. And that's where I really learned to read music. And I got to like to read it.
That's every parent's dream, that their children will like piano lessons. But you started professionally at a very early age.
Well, I was rather lucky. My two older sisters, Chris and Pauline, were already in radio when I was still in school. They were already singing in the local station in Long Beach. They had moved up to Hollywood by the time I graduated from high school, which my mother insisted upon. But I graduated on Friday afternoon from high school. I was up with them by Monday and started singing with them, which made it a lot easier. You know, they'd already knocked on the doors. So it was, I just joined them, and we worked a whole lot here in town, radio, and a lot of background music in movies. As I say, I had a vacation over the weekend, and then I was a working girl.
Was California Melodies the first major program you were involved with?
Yes. David Brookman was the conductor. Remember him? He was a real, real hard conductor, but yeah, I learned a lot from him. That was Coast to Coast show. Yeah, that was the first big one. We had our own little 15-minute show on, I guess it was KHJ, when they were still downtown in Los Angeles. And we had our own 15-minute show 3 days a week. And I'll never forget, there was a whole big cattle call, as we called them, audition at KHJ. This man came out and says, "Is there anybody here, any act here that has their own accompaniment?" And my sister Chris said, "We do." Well, you know, I almost fainted because I was the piano player and I had no idea of playing the piano except for just to rehearse us. Well, we wound up with our own 15-minute show and me pounding away on the piano very badly, but that was it. She fixed me.
Would you talk about working on A Damsel in Distress?
Oh, my golly, with Fred Astaire. Oh,
yes.
Wow. With Fred Astaire, I had a colossal jolt because I not only played the piano, I made the arrangements for us. And then the song that we did with him was Nice Work. So I had a thing going, "Nice work if you can get it, and you can get it." Did you know that Fred Astaire couldn't do that? He couldn't do the bump, bump, to the, "and you can," he couldn't do that. And I was never so shocked in my life. We just had to go back to, "and you can get it." The man with the syncopated shoes couldn't do the syncopated notes. It was very strange.
Were you intimidated working with him?
Not when he couldn't do those pickups.
I guess that would change the idolatry very quickly.
Yes. No, not really. He was a tremendous artist.
What other movies did you work on?
Oh, we were in the Alexander's Ragtime Band, I guess, was the biggest.
Did you have a favorite studio to work at?
Well, I suppose if I had to pick a favorite, I'd pick MGM, because it seems like everything they did was first class. But we did a lot of work at 20th, because they were the big musical makers.
And 20th, the great choral director, was Charles Henderson.
I remember Charles. He was a tyrant. Oh.
Was he? I don't know anything about him.
You don't?
I just know his arrangements, which I think are extraordinary and very difficult.
Well, he was funny. He was a real yeller at singers. To be late for one of his calls, I mean, you know, it was just death. And the Stafford sisters were never on time. I'm talking about maybe 5 or 10 minutes, but we were quite good at being late. But do you know that he never said one cross word to us? Because we could sing jazz.
Mm.
That got us over the hump. Then there was a man at Paramount, Nick somebody.
Who did vocal arrangements?
Well, he did the same thing that Henderson.
And Boris Morris, did you work with Boris Morris?
I don't know if we ever did or not.
I just love the name. I love saying it.
You made that up.
Did you work with Georgie Stoll?
Oh, yes, a lot. Georgie was the conductor on a radio show. Can't remember. I think it was for Camel Cigarettes.
Camel Caravan.
Camel Caravan.
Yeah.
And Georgie was the conductor. And the Stafford sisters worked that. We did a half hour here. Then the other half hour was Benny Goodman in New York. That's where Benny found Martha Tilton. She was in the chorus, too.
Really?
That I was in. So that's where I first really met and worked with Georgie Stoll, was on that Camel Caravan, yeah.
Do you recall any of the titles of the MGM films you worked on?
We did some musical shorts at MGM.
On camera or off?
Oh, off. We never were on camera.
Was it a training that was valuable for your later work?
In that it required, well, even group singing requires that, a discipline that solo singing doesn't. Group singing, you know, you can't go off on your own.
The musical arrangements for the movies in the 1930s are so much more advanced than the Broadway orchestrations of that time, which are rather square. There's no innovative choral work. Why do you suppose that is?
I don't know, but I certainly know what you mean, because I was raised on that studio music, which, as you say, was quite advanced and quite good. And on my first trip to New York, when I was going to go, my first experience of going to a New York musical, I was thrilled to death. And I almost walked out before the overture was over. So I never heard such pitiful arrangements of such great songs. You know, it was just awful, or I thought it was. I still do. I mean, the idea of making an orchestration for the overture of South Pacific and having Some Enchanted Evening featured with a muted trumpet playing the melody. I mean, how do you come to that conclusion? I don't know.
And they always had the melody in the orchestration.
Yeah, I once ran into that. I was doing a radio show in New York, the conductor being Robert Russell Bennett, the great white god of New York
Broadway
musicals. And in came this orchestration with a melody. I really got up on my hind legs and I said, I know the melody. And take that out.
And did he?
Yes.
Good.
That's a wasted line that you could use in some nice counter melodies or something, you know.